We are in a series called The Power of What? The Power of Re. The Power of Re. Now, we talked about the word, the prefix re, meaning again, right? It means again. And so that's going to be a really big thing for us today with what you're going to hear me talk about in just a minute. But we talked in week one, we talked about the word rename, and we got new names on that day. Then in week two, we shifted into resist. And last week, we talked about resist the devil and he will flee from you. We resist him by being with God. And then this morning, I want to talk about a word that I love. In fact, I was trying to find the song and I didn't get to talk to Evelyn before service. I don't know if Dad ever figured it out or Tommy, but there was a song that we used to sing when I was growing up here through the 90s, probably started back in the 80s, really. And at the end of the song, we would shout this word and I can hear Evelyn echo in my mind. I can hear her shout this word and she's going to know this word and she's probably going to know the song as soon as I read this. Listen to what Philippians chapter 4, verse 4 says. This is awesome. It says, Paul speaks to the church at Philippi, rejoice. Yeah. Evelyn used to shout it at the end of this song. The song would end and she would go, rejoice. And she'd like pump her fist in the air like this, right? Yeah. You remember that?
Yes.
It's good stuff. It says, rejoice. Say it with me.
Rejoice.
Come on, say it one more time.
Rejoice,
rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord when? Always. Again, I say rejoice. So I want to talk to you, and the way that he writes it here, the word that came to my mind was, we're gonna put rejoice on repeat. Come on, somebody. Put rejoice on repeat. I will rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Anybody remember how many of you guys have been through a lot of the history of the way that we listen to music? You've been there for the records. You've been there for the 8-track, right? Come on. You know, maybe I should have explained. Anybody 8-track age? 8-track age? Come on. Yeah, we used to have a guy on our softball team. He was a pitcher, and he was the oldest guy on our team, and we gave everybody a nickname. We nicknamed him 8-track. That was what we called him. And, you know, it was funny because people say that the 8-track season was the best season for music. And they said the reason was because the whole album had to be good. Because you had to keep driving if you wanted to hear a song you liked, right? If there was a song on the album that you liked when it played, you had to go cruise around for 45 more minutes so you could hear it again. Ted Kirkland is over here. Yes, sir, that is right. And so I didn't grow up in the 8-track age, but I did grow up in the cassette tape age. Come on, how many of you cassette tape age people? You remember very well the cassette tape. And when the cassette tape age was around, it was great because you could rewind and fast forward. The problem was you guys that grew up in cassette tape age, you can relate to this. You would try to rewind it and you'd have to stop it and listen to where it was and it wasn't at the right spot, so you rewind it again. And you know what I'm talking about, everybody with me? And so the cassette tape age was better than the 8-track age as far as being able to listen to what you wanted to listen to. But then something happened around the mid-90s. And I remember when we got our first one, because my dad bought my mom, still to this day, I think he says it's the most expensive car that he ever bought her. It was a 1995 Mitsubishi Galant. Come on, somebody, can I get an amen? And it was the most expensive car my dad had ever bought my mom. And that was the first car we had that had a CD player in it. Come on, somebody, can I get a, I mean, we was moving on up to the east side, right? And we had that CD player. And I remember one of the very first CDs that I ever bought was the All For One album that was just titled All For One. That was one of my very first CDs. My mom, I've told this before, she joined Columbia House where you pay one penny and you get 918 CDs, but then you have to buy the next 20 CDs, but they're $1,000 a piece. Like, that's how my mom did all of our CDs. But I got the All For One album. And you remember back in those days, they shifted to where they started coming out with singles, right, CDs. Because at that time, all you 8-track people would say that's because the album was terrible and there was only one good song on the whole album, and you bought the whole album for one song. And so I remember that All For One, it was called All For One, that was the name of the group and the title of the album. And I put it in, and the best song on there was a song that I used to woo a lot of women with. And see if you guys remember this. And I swear by the moon and the stars in the sky, I'll be there. Y'all remember? Yeah, and my mom used to get so mad because we would get in the car when the Gallant, and for the first time ever, I was able to push a button that said, repeat. Come on, how many of you remember? Changed our life. You can listen to the same song over and over and over and over again. And the good thing about putting it on repeat is if you didn't like it at first, you'd liked it by the time you was done because you was going to hear it over and over and over again. And I think about that that button and about how much that changed the music game and how you could just listen to something over and over and over again. And I thought about how that is exactly what Paul is wanting us to understand in the Spirit here. That there is actually something in our life that can click. There is a button that can be pressed by the Spirit. Listen to me. There is a spiritual experience that you can have with the Holy Spirit where he pushes a button that is repeat, and it is not complaining and it is not negativity, but it is an attitude of rejoicing. That's what I long for. I want to put rejoicing on repeat in my life. So that's what we're going to talk about today. Let's look at what he says here. Number one, if you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. Number one, you have the choice to rejoice. I don't know where you are right now, what you're going through, but I want you to hear me. You have a choice to rejoice. The problem is we have all been trained to complain. Come on, see what I did there? I worked very hard to put all that together and piece it together for you. How many of you know rejoicing is not the default for any of us? Come on. Rejoicing is not the default. I don't know if you know what default means, but if you don't, it's kind of a computer word. And basically everything in your computer has a default setting so that when you turn your computer on, even if you change the setting later, it will automatically defer to the default setting and it will go back to what it was. And the reality is for us, we are born into a default setting of complaining. We are born into a default setting of negativity, and we have to choose and be intentional on rejoicing. Let me tell you what I mean. Let me explain it this way. How many of you guys remember getting your first car? Raise your hand if you remember getting your first car. How many of you have still never gotten a first car? Raise your hand. And so I remember, the first car experience is a big thing. How many of you are in the room right now and you were the people that I was jealous of? You got like a really nice new car. Like anybody, like raise your hand, be real. Yeah, there we go. Look at you. Spoiled. Anybody else like you? Yeah, so like, yep, Casey. Yeah, Casey says, she's trying not to let nobody see her right now. She's like, I got a new car. And so I was the opposite of you people, okay? I was the exact opposite. I will say at least, how many of you got a car that didn't run? Anybody? You got a car that didn't run? There you go, a couple people. Yeah, I wasn't quite there, but I was just the tier above you. Like, I was right at you. I remember I was coming home, and I was in North Carolina at my mom's sister Gail's house. I don't know what I was doing up there. I was probably just visiting, but I was coming home, and I pulled in the driveway. I'll never forget it, and my dad had my first car sitting in the driveway. And before you get too excited, let me explain a few little things about it, okay? When I pulled in, I had no idea that it was going to be sitting there, and it was a 1986 Mazda 626, and it was purple. Come on, somebody. And I've told this before, in case you've never heard this, this isn't the point, but I've told this before. It wouldn't crank unless you got a couple people in the car with you and you had to rock the car back and forth. I don't know what that did. Like, seriously, like you had to rock the car. Like, nothing would happen. Like, if you just turned the key. But if you got a couple of your buddies in there and you got to moving a little bit and started rocking back and forth, you turned the key on and it would finally crank. But you know what, man? When I got that car, I was the most excited person on the planet. You know how much my first car cost? $325. $325. Now, for those of you who have never paid for anything in your life, you can't buy some tires for $325, all right? And so this was not, but I was so excited and I was rejoicing. And let me tell you, I went out and I began to make investments into this car. Listen, I put 2 15-inch speakers in my trunk, because listen, if you had to rock to get it started, it's good to have a good system, right? To get rocked. rocking too. And so I put a big system in the trunk and I was booming everywhere. Listen, I had a car that when you pulled up to the red light, my wheels kept spinning. Come on, somebody, that's right. I had spinners on it, but it wasn't real spinners. It was the ones you got at Walmart that pop in, right? Like they weren't real spinners. They were the plastic kind that you pop in. And I was so excited. And you know what? When I look back at that, if people would have looked at my car, and I would probably look at it now, and I would be like, John, you were so lame being so excited about that car, because I drove that thing around like it was a brand new Mercedes, ladies and gentlemen. I was pulling up to the drive, and I was looking at the guy, the red light next to me with my music pumping, my wheels still spinning, like, what's up? Yep, this is me. And it was just great. And I rejoiced. Why? Not because of the vehicle. I wasn't rejoicing because of the vehicle. I was rejoicing because of where that vehicle could get me. Come on. Am I right? Anybody know what I'm talking about? I wasn't excited at the 1986 Mazda 626 that was purple that you had to rock to crank. That is not what excited me. What excited me is I could go to my girlfriend's house in it. That's what excited me. What excited me is I could go out to eat and I didn't need mom and dad. I could go to the movies and I didn't need mom and dad. So it wasn't the fact of the vehicle that got me excited, but it was where the vehicle could get me. Now this will preach. You see, real rejoicing doesn't come because you like every situation you find yourself in. See, that's where people confuse it. People want to go, you up there telling me to rejoice and you don't know what I'm going through, and you know, you wouldn't rejoice in this either. I'm not telling you that what you're going through is fun. The Bible even says that Jesus was led by joy to the cross. Not because he was excited about the cross, not because he was excited about the crucifixion, not because it wasn't going to physically hurt him, but because the Bible says the joy came from where? From what was set before him. He knew that that cross was a vehicle to get him somewhere that he was not at, or that in our case, it was really that we were not there. And he was getting us somewhere, so that everything in our life, you've got to look at it and you've got to say, you know what? I'm not going to complain. I'm not going to just look down on everything I'm going through, but I'm going to look at everything and realize I don't have to be excited about the vehicle. But what I know is that God is up to something. God is doing something. The Bible says to rejoice in the Lord when? Always. And again, I say rejoice. He says rejoice. The words for rejoice, if you didn't know, there are these Greek words for rejoice. There are two of them. One is a noun and one is a verb. And I want you to hear me. Listen to me. If you will use the verb, you will get the noun. If you will use the verb, you will end up with the noun. People want the noun first. You don't get the noun first. You get the verb first. Why? Because that's the faith. The faith is the verb. The words for rejoice in the Greek are one word was the word kara, and the other word is the name Cairo. And both of these names, what was really cool was these words, they weren't just words that you would use to say, hey, I'm going to rejoice. These words in their language were actually greetings and they were farewells in every conversation. So when you came into a room or you came into a conversation, you would always start with the word kara. You would always say, I rejoice, you know, and then when you would leave, you would say, I rejoice. And I thought about how these words were actually used in their day and how Paul was using it here. And I thought about that passage. What does the Bible say? I'm blessed going in and I'm blessed going out. And it don't matter what I'm going into, I'm blessed because I'm going to come out. And it doesn't matter what I'm coming out of, I'm blessed because I'm going to go into something new. Listen, you've got to live with this mentality. Listen, guys, I'm blessed going in. I'm blessed going out. No one can take that from me. And I choose to look at everything that I'm in, not as just the vehicle, but I look at it as the destination to where I'm going. And that's how I can actually rejoice always. You see, rejoice is not a feeling. Listen to me, guys. Rejoicing is not a feeling. I've got to be able to rejoice when I don't feel it. Rejoice is an action. It's what I choose to do. No matter what I go through, I choose to rejoice. Because I know that what I'm going through is going to take me somewhere. There was a commercial I was watching television last night, and I don't watch commercials. For those of you who don't know that, I change every time a commercial pops up. They drive me crazy. But it must have been the Lord, because I just so happened to be sitting there listening to a commercial, and the commercial said this, and I wrote it down. It says, "What if joy is not is the whole game and not just the end game? What if joy is actually the whole game and it's not just the end game? What if I can actually have joy in everything that I go through? What if I can actually rejoice in everything I go through? I'm not waiting to rejoice, but I actually have the ability to choose to rejoice in everything that I go through." Number two, write this down. It's time to get off the seesaw. It's time to get off the seesaw. So as you see here, I have a playground set up here. And when I was thinking about what Paul is saying here about rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say rejoice, this is gonna make a little bit more sense later, because I'm actually gonna give you the history of where Paul was when he wrote this and why it was such a big deal to the church at Philippi that he wrote this way. In a minute, this will make more sense. But I had this illustration that came into my mind. You see, for a lot of us, life is a seesaw. And what I mean by that is when we're on the seesaw, and let's say that we want to play on the seesaw. Let me get it where I can get all the way down so it looks more ridiculous. How many of you know when it comes to the seesaw, if you want to play on the seesaw, this isn't really anything you can do by yourself? Anybody ever been on a seesaw by yourself and you did the whole thing where you were trying to pick yourself up and jump? Anybody ever done that, right? You see, the thing about the seesaw is if the seesaw is going to be enjoyable, if the seesaw is going to be fun, what has to happen? Something has to be on the other side of it to lift you up. Are you with me? See, there are a lot of people that I know that this is how they live their life, that the only way they are ever gonna be lifted up is if something or someone is on the other side of their life making them lift up. And you are somebody that you constantly need somebody to come and lift you up. You constantly need something to come and lift you up. You can't enjoy life if you don't do this. You can't enjoy life if you're not with this person. And everything about your life is a seesaw, and the only enjoyment is when someone else is there to lift you up. But let me tell you something. Rejoicing is supposed to come no matter what I see or what I saw. Come on, somebody. Ooh, that's pretty good. It don't matter what I see, it don't matter what I saw, I should be rejoicing. And that's why we gotta get off the seesaw, and we gotta get back on the swing. And I'm afraid this thing's gonna break, so I'm not gonna really do it for you. I was gonna do it. I was gonna swing. But you know what I love about the swing? Is I don't need somebody. Listen, sometimes people will push you on the swing, and that's great, that's wonderful. But if you ain't here to push me, guess what? I can get myself up. I can create my own momentum. I don't have to have somebody there with me every time I gotta be lifted up. I don't have to have somebody patting me on the back. I don't have to have somebody telling me it's gonna be okay. I don't have to have somebody, because I've got it in myself. We've got to get off of the seesaw and onto the swing and say, listen, if somebody's there to push me, then that's wonderful. That's great. It's wonderful to be pushed, but I don't have to have you push me. I don't have to have good things happen to me on the outside for me to create momentum for me to get myself up on the inside, because I've got something in me down in my bones called the Holy Spirit, and he is a comforter, and he is a counselor, and he is a guide, and he will be the one to give me the momentum to pick myself up when nobody else is there to pick me up. Yeah. Woo. I wrote down, I don't care what I see or what I saw, I am going to rejoice. Why? Because I have a reason to rejoice. Now, why is this such a big deal in the passage that Paul writes to the church at Philippi? I don't know if you know how the church at Philippi started or why this meant a lot to them versus what it means to us. But the church, the book of Philippians, I just want to tell you, if you're down right now, if you are struggling, Let me give you, write you a prescription real quick. Read the book of Philippians. Because in this little book, it ain't but four chapters. Look at your neighbor and say, ain't but four chapters. Even you can read this. It ain't but four chapters. In four chapters, Paul writes 16 times, rejoice. 16 times he says, have joy. This book is a book of encouragement, and it's such a strategic thing of why he did this. But it's in this book that Paul wrote some of these things. See if you remember these words. Paul says, I know this one thing. He who started a good work is faithful to complete it. He writes that in the book of Philippians. He's not trying to argue theology. He's not trying to talk about the leadership of the church. He's trying to encourage God's people to say, listen, you can rejoice. See if you remember this one. He says, this one thing I do, forgetting what is behind me, and I'm pressing towards what is ahead. He says that to the church at Philippi. He says this, that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He says that to the church at Philippi. He says this. He asked the people one time. He says, listen, did you not know that you are citizens of heaven? The word politico there, citizens of heaven. He says, you are not of this world. You are a kingdom citizen, and you are not operating like a kingdom citizen. Listen, I don't like to be the guy that tears people down. I don't like to be the guy that makes people feel bad. But it's time for the church to stand up and to begin to look at each other and hold each other accountable and say, you're not acting like a kingdom citizen. It's time for us to do that. I mean, we got to start looking at each other when each other gets down. And we got to say, nope, this is not what a kingdom citizen is supposed to be doing. Did you not know? We got to start asking each other. Listen, when you look at somebody and they're not rejoicing and they're a Jesus person, you need to look at them and say, did you not know you are a kingdom citizen? You have something to rejoice about. You have reason to rejoice. He says this, I love this one. He says, I've learned. Why? Because again, it's not default. We have to learn to rejoice. We have to learn these things. We've got to grow up in God, in the Spirit. You can't stay a baby where people have to come and just check on you all the time. And if you're going to grow, they got to stand in front of you and they got to make faces and they got to make you laugh and they got to, listen, you got to get over all that. And you've got to learn. And what Paul goes on to say, he says, I've learned in all things how to be content. I've learned in all things how to be content. He said, I've been broken, I've been balling. And I know how to be thankful in both. I know how to be thankful in both. All through this book, man, he writes with this encouraging word. And do you know where he was the entire time that he wrote this book? He's in prison. He's in prison. And he's writing to a church that was birthed out of a prison experience. I don't know if you know how the church at Philippi was birthed, but it was birthed in Acts chapter 16 when the Bible says that Paul wanted to go to Asia, but the Holy Spirit stopped him. Because how many of you know we have a God that not only does he order our steps, he also orders our stops. Come on, somebody, that'll preach. And that's why some of us need to look back at 2020 and we need to thank God. We need to lift our hands and rejoice about 2020, because what you don't know is that he actually had a moment where he was ordering a stop, because if he had let you keep going, if he had let me keep going, we was about to go into some stuff that we weren't ready to go into, and he needed a holy time out and he stopped. So listen, those stop moments, those are important. And the Bible says that instead of going to Asia, that Paul ends up actually going to Macedonia. And his first landing spot on his way to Macedonia was a city called Philippi. And when he gets to Philippi, there's this woman there that is actually a soothsayer or a fortune teller. She's demon possessed. There's a lot that goes along with this chick. And she starts shouting at Paul and Silas and telling them that there are people of the Most High God and all of this. And the Bible says that Paul actually cast the demon out of her, and he saves. She gets saved, and the master that was getting money from her gets mad about it, and they lock Paul and Silas up in prison. You remember this story? Because this is the story where Paul and Silas are sitting in prison, and the Bible says it's about midnight. It's dark. At midnight, it says that they were chained up. Couldn't see anything. They were in a city they had never been to. They didn't know anybody. And it says all of a sudden, at about midnight, after they had been beaten and flogged, the Bible says, they were beaten and flogged. And it says, at about midnight, that Paul and Silas began singing praises to God. And that word singing praises to God, it wasn't just some form of just singing for the sake of singing. It is actually a way to write. They were actually rejoicing. They were rejoicing while they were in prison. They were rejoicing while they were locked up. They were rejoicing, and they were in prison for no good reason at all, but yet they were rejoicing, and they were singing songs to God. And it was in that moment that the Bible says that an earthquake came, and it shook the foundation of the prison, and the prison doors flew open, and all the chains fell off of all the people. And we see this miraculous story about God setting them free. Why? Because they were rejoicing even when they didn't feel like they should be rejoicing. They rejoiced anyway, and out of that was birthed the church of Philippi. So when Paul tells them rejoice in the Lord always, they don't think about it like we think about it, because we want to say, well, you don't know what I'm going through. But when they read it, they said, oh yeah, if Paul says that, we better listen, because y'all remember, like, that was when he was singing praises in prison. But what's really interesting that you don't read in the book of Philippians chapter 4 is that Paul is actually not writing the book of Philippians. He is not writing that book in the prison at the church at Philippi. He's actually in prison in Rome. And he's actually on death row. And guess what? He's in a prison, and Silas isn't with him. In fact, nobody is with him this time. The Bible actually tells us at the beginning of Philippians that Paul is actually writing this letter to the church at Philippi while he is attached to a secret service agent of the Roman government. And what they would do is they would take high-profile criminals, and they would handcuff themselves to that criminal, and they would do 6-hour shifts, and each guard would do it 6 hours a day for 2 years. 2 years. So when Paul went to the bathroom, when Paul wanted to sleep, they were spooning. He is attached not to another brother of faith, but to somebody who wants to see him dead. And listen, the real question becomes, the real question is this: can you rejoice then? It's one thing to rejoice when you got Silas in prison with you, and you're not all by yourself. Because listen, the Philippians prison, Acts 16, that's the seesaw. He wasn't by himself. He had somebody with him to help build him up, encourage him. But what about when you are in Rome and you are hooked up with the enemy? And the Bible says, do you know what the Bible says? The Bible says Paul rejoiced in that moment, because he said, you know what this is called? This is called a captive audience. And if you're a preacher, there's no better person to preach to than the person that is literally chained to you, because they can't leave. Like, you can say whatever you want to say. And when Paul was thinking about this, everybody else was going, man, poor Paul. He's in prison and he's chained up with this guy. And Paul's going, man, don't say poor Paul. He says, man, I'm pumped up. I'm excited. Yeah, but you're in prison. You're on death row. You're chained to strange men, men that want to kill you. What in the world? He says, yeah, but think about it. I get the next 2 years to tell them about Jesus. And Paul's mentality was this. Paul was saying, listen, I'm not chained to them. They are chained to me. Come on, somebody. They're chained to me. That's how we need to look at it. I think about people like Jamie Corley, who's probably watching right now, and how he's still going for treatments and he's still going to the hospital. We're years into what I see as healing because this is not supposed to be, and who Jamie is not supposed to be. And there are people who wonder, well, why does Jamie still have these doctor's reports? Why does Jamie still have to go to the hospital? And my thing is, man, Jamie's not chained to cancer at this point. At this point, cancer is chained to Jamie. Come on, somebody, because he gets to go in every day to that hospital and tell somebody about Jesus. And he gets to look at somebody that got a bad report and he said, I got a bad report too, but look at me. I look great. I'm still here. It hasn't taken me out. So listen, you've got to change the way that you look at it, and you've got to say, I don't need somebody else or something else or some other life situation, but I can do it all by myself. All by myself. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5, verse 3, it says, more than that, we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance. So again, it's not about the vehicle. It is about what comes out of it. You know that when Paul was in prison in Rome, he didn't just write the book of Philippians, but he also wrote the book of Ephesians, and he wrote the book of Colossians. And he wrote the book of Philemon. And all of this was being produced out of him. Why? Because he was choosing to rejoice in the middle of circumstances where it did not look like he could rejoice. Man, you choose. You choose to live a life of rejoicing. Last thing, number three, Dad, you come on up. The kingdom of God, you have to remember, operates on the principle of sowing and reaping. Everything in the kingdom, everything is sowing and reaping. I believe this with all of my heart. I don't have time to go into the depths of the studies that I've done on this matter, but I'm just here to tell you that literally everything in the kingdom of God is a sowing and reaping principle. And when I think about that, I think about how I got to remind myself sometimes, and I'll remind you of the same thing today. Listen to me. God does not inhabit the complaints of his people. Come on, somebody. God inhabits the praises of his people. It's a sowing and reaping deal, man. It's sowing and reaping. And we have to change. We to choose to allow change to come so that we can rejoice, so that he inhabits the praises of his people. Because at the end of the day, guys, listen to me. I want you to hear this. He's the only one that can change it anyway. He's the only one that can change it anyway. Mark chapter 4, verse 26 says, he also said, this is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows. Though he does not know how, all by itself, the soil produces grain, first the stalk, then the head, then the full kernel in the head. And as soon as the grain is ripe, he puts it to the sickle because the harvest has come. So you've got to understand as well, one of the hard things for us to understand when it comes to rejoicing is it is a sowing and reaping principle, and there are multiple phases of this. Listen, guys, the first thing that happens is the planting phase. Do you know what the planting phase is? The planting phase is the rejoicing phase. Listen to me. The planting phase is when you choose to rejoice even though everybody says there's nothing there to rejoice about. The planting phase is when you choose to speak life even when it looks like there is death all around you. You just have to make sure that you are planting the right seed. Because here's what I know. Listen to me. The planting phase starts right here. And if I can get my mind out of where I am, then everything connected will follow. Listen to me. If I can get my mind out, then everything connected to the brain will follow where the brain goes. And so we choose to plant. And we plant the right things. The second phase is he talks about a plowing phase. Now, this is backwards to us because in our culture, we actually plow first, then we plant. But that is not the way that it was in their day, nor is it the way God uses it in the kingdom. Listen, the sowing phase always comes before the planting phase. I mean, the plowing phase. The plowing comes up after you've sown. It is the faith that follows. See, you can't invert that process. What people want to do actually is they want to reap before they sow or before they plow. And you can't invert that process. You plant, you sow, then you plow by faith, and then there's what we call the growing phase. Now, here's what's hard about the growing phase. The growing phase is not constant. There are some things that happen in the kingdom that happen in a moment. There are some things that were in the kingdom in the Bible days that went through generations. That's why I'm telling you, you can't give up because you don't know what it is that you have started that the next generation is actually the one that is going to see it come to pass. And if you give up now, then the next generation will never see it. The growing phase changes. That's why Paul says, I rejoice in the Lord always. Whether the growing phase takes a minute, whether the growing phase takes a year, or whether the growing phase takes generations, I will rejoice. Because after the growing phase comes the harvest phase. And listen to me, you always reap what you sow. So if you choose not to sow rejoicing, then whatever it is that you put in the place of rejoicing, that is actually what you reap from. That's the tree that will grow, and that is the tree that you will actually reap from. I thought about this in Joshua chapter 6, verse 2. It says, then the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have delivered Jericho into your hands along with its king and its fighting men. He's already talking in the past tense because here's what I know. Do you know why I can rejoice in the Lord always? Because God is the only thing that is always. Past, present, future. And I've said this before, we're not fighting for victory, we're fighting from victory, and that's what he shows us here. He says, listen, where you are right now is not a determination of where I'm actually taking you. So don't worry, there's victory ahead. And he says, listen, I've already delivered these people into your hands. He says, march around the city once with all the armed men. Do this for 6 days. Have 7 priests carry trumpets of ram's horns in front of the ark. On the 7th day, march around the city 7 times. And when the priests blowing the trumpets, when you hear them sound a long blast on the trumpets, have the whole army give a loud shout. Then the wall of the city will collapse and the army will go up and everyone will go straight in. What is he saying here? He's saying, listen, I'm telling you that you're going to have to sow before you reap. You're going to have to plant. You're going to have to plow. And then you're going to reap. But do you know why they were so faithful to do what the Bible says God told them to do? Because their eyes weren't set on the wall. Their eyes weren't set on the other army. Their eyes were set on him. And they had proven that for 5 chapters up until this. They had proven that their eyes were set on him. Listen, the chapter before this, God tells them all to go circumcise each other. Yeah. If you do that, your eyes are on God. Like if you're like, yeah, we're gonna listen, you're all in. Their eyes were on him the entire time. And so that way when they got to the moment where they were able to march around that city, and again, they didn't see a brick fall, they didn't see a soldier fall, they didn't see anything good happen out of it. But when they got there and they were marching around and they were given that command, at the sound of your shout, at the sound of your rejoicing, and that word shout there, it was not just some obscure shout, it was actually a victory shout. That's what it was. It was a shout of rejoicing. And they had not yet won a battle, they had not even fought a battle, but they got there to that moment and they marched around that city and they shouted out with rejoicing anyway. And because they did that, they reaped from what they sowed, and the wall came down and they took the city of Jericho. And the same is true for you. You sow. Nobody ever sows by what they see. Nobody ever sows by what they see, because if you sow it, you haven't yet seen it. But I sow because of what I know God is going to do, because I know what God is speaking, I know what God is saying. I'm focused on him, and I choose to rejoice in everything that I go through. Amen? Let's stand up on our feet this morning. Man, you guys could come on up.